kindly someone give me a thumbs up in the chat box if I'm clearly visible and audible. There was some technical issue, that's why I got late. I'm sorry for being late. There was some technical issue, the video was not running. Give me a thumbs up right in the chat box if I'm clearly visible and audible so I can start ahead fast. Okay, thanks. Thanks for confirmation. So welcome for today's session. I am Dr. Priyanka Sachdev here, medical entrance educator on an academy. And today I am here to continue my series, that is Target FMG. So we are targeting here FMGE December 2021, right? So I hope all the audience is the FMG aspirant, maybe this December, or maybe some of them, some of you are for the next FMG, but you are targeting FMG because my total content will be directed towards FMG only. So today I'm continuing my pathology lecture here. We have started pathology yesterday only. From pathology, we have covered the first topic, cell adaptation, cell injury, cell death, apoptosis, necrosis, done or not. So today I'm starting the second chapter of pathology, inflammation. Time is left, time is very less, so I will be a little bit faster. If you have any doubt, please type in the chat box. Deepu, if you have any doubt, please write in the chat box. As soon as I will find time, appropriate time, I will address it. So without wasting any further time, I'm starting with inflammation. Here I will teach you both inflammations today, acute as well as chronic. Done. So I'm starting with inflammation. Just give me 1 minute. Inflammation. So what is inflammation? What is inflammation? Don't get confused between the two terms, infection and inflammation. I'm a human body. Just suppose any bacteria or any microbe enters inside my body. By microbe, I mean four things will be there: bacteria, virus, fungus and parasite. Anything entering inside my body, the thing that is causing inside me will be infection. My body will oppose it. My body will oppose it by doing some reactions. That is known as inflammation. So inflammation is a protective response done in against to infection. If the parasite will win, microbe will win, I will have infection. If my body's response will win, I will have inflammation. So inflammation is basically body's defense mechanism against the microbes. So we have four types of microbes: bacteria, virus, fungus and parasite. Whenever any of them is entering inside our body opposes it by inflammation. So bacteria causes infection, our body opposes it by inflammation. Done. So we can say inflammation is a body defense mechanism in order to eliminate or limit the spread of the injurious agent. Done. Who is doing it? Who is the army? Who is fighting with the terrorist? These all are terrorists. Bacteria, virus, fungus, parasite, these are microbes. All microbes are terrorists. They are entering in human body. So who is the army? Who is our army who is protecting us? The army is WBC. So today I will tell you a story, a very beautiful, the whole inflammation will be taught in the form of a beautiful story. You will never forget. You will never forget. So you know the causes of inflammation, okay? There are two types of inflammation, acute and chronic. So we will understand the two types by taking example. We all have tonsillitis, right? Tonsillitis. We all have tonsillitis at some or other our life stage. Yes, tonsillitis is very common. Now we all have faced. That is an example of acute inflammation. And chronic is tuberculosis. We will take example. Done. So just a second. Tonsillitis, just suppose, is caused by a bacteria known as Streptococcus pneumoniae. And tuberculosis is also caused by a bacteria known as Mycobacterium tuberculosis. Done. So both of them are bacteria. Now, whenever this Streptococcus pneumoniae entering inside my body, it will cause tonsillitis even after entering within 1 to 3 hours, 3 to 4 hours. So that is onset is very rapid. As soon as bacteria is entering inside the human body, it is causing the disease. So that is known as onset. Onset is the time between entering of the microbe till the first symptom. So that is nearly few hours only. That is onset. I will have tonsillitis, severe throat pain, tonsillitis, but I will be all right in the next 7 days, in the next 5 to 7 days. That is, duration of illness is very short. So onset is rapid, duration of illness is short, and I will have edema in that particular part. So if I'm having inflammation in the tonsil, I will have edema in the tonsil. That is a hallmark of acute inflammation. No acute inflammation without edema. And neutrophils are the main cells causing this. I will explain you the whole process. This is the difference. Now consider the other situation. If some person is having tuberculosis, so Mycobacterium tuberculosis bacteria is entering inside the human body, but it will present in the lungs for years, years, years. And when the immunity of the person is dropping, at that time he will have tuberculosis. That is, onset is very late. So bacteria is present in the human body for years as a dormant. Just give me 1 second. Let me shift here. Okay. I think it's clear now. Okay, I'm sorry. So that is onset is late. And if the person is having tuberculosis once, then if you take the treatment, it will last for 6 months. If you do not take the treatment, it will last for years and years and years. So duration is also long. Here the hallmark is granuloma formation. And here main cells will be macrophages and lymphocytes. So never forget the differences. Have you got the differences? Should I proceed? So I will start with acute inflammation first. Acute inflammation. In acute inflammation, there are 5 cardinal signs. Never forget. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So whatever organ from head to toe, we can have acute inflammation in any body organ. So in meninges, it can be meningitis. In tonsil, it can be tonsillitis. In orbit, it can be endophthalmitis. So it can occur rhinitis, bronchitis, appendicitis. It can occur in any organ. So whatever organ it is occurring, that organ will show 5 things. Number one, the organ will become red. See, the tonsils here are red. So number one, tonsils, the organ will become red. The temperature of that particular organ will increase as compared to rest of the organ. So tonsils will be hot as compared to rest of the temperature. So that is, temperature is increasing. The tonsils are swelled here. Swelling will be a feature. Swelling. Pain will be there. Of course, pain is not visible here, but pain will be there. And temporary loss of function is there. Temporary. It is not permanent. Temporary loss of function is there. So it is not only for this tonsil. It is for any organ who is having acute inflammation, these 5 cardinal signs. Now, examiner likes Latin language very much. So these, instead of English language, you have to say these 5 cardinal signs in Latin. That will be answered in your exam. I don't know why, but you have to learn. So redness in Latin is known as rubor. Increased body temperature, local temperature, it is known as calor, calorimeter, calor. Done. Swelling is known as tumor. It is a misnomer. Tumor matlab wo malignancy wala tumor nahi hai ye. This tumor in Latin means swelling. It means swelling. It is not English tumor. It is Latin tumor. Done. Pain means dolor, dolor. And loss of function means functiolasia. So rubor, calor, tumor, dolor, and functiolasia. These are the 5 cardinal signs of acute inflammation. Many MCQs comes from it. Please learn it. Please learn it. The first 4 signs, rubor, calor, tumor, and dolor, are given by a scientist known as Celsius. And the last one is given by Virchow. Last one is added later on by Virchow. 5 cardinal signs of acute inflammation. Rubor, calor, tumor, dolor, loss of functiolasia. Done. The first 4 by Celsius. The 5th one is by Virchow. And you know the meaning of each of them. Should I proceed ahead? Should I proceed ahead? Based on these cardinal signs, there is a poll for you. So this is the poll. Read the question and mark the correct answer. First, very easy question. I guess it is very easy question. Yes? I guess it is very, very easy question. So all are Celsius signs of inflammation except, the question contains except. Please see, the question contains except. Who will tell me the correct answer? Yes, you all are correct. The correct answer here is C, to sinuses, honey, Anand and Aran are first to answer it correctly. Very good. So the correct answer here is sinuses. Pain, swelling and redness are the Celsius, are the Celsius signs of inflammation, but not sinuses. Done. So correct answer. Now let me tell you how acute inflammation takes place. So there are vascular events, there are cellular events. There are 5 vascular events, there are 6 cellular events. Total there are 11 events. So I will teach you all 11 events, don't worry. So these are the 5 vascular events. I'm not reading one by one, I will explain you all. These are the 6 cellular events and total there are 11 events. So this is my master diagram for today, in which I will explain you all 11 events in this diagram. So those who can understand this diagram, only those students will understand all 11 events in the next 1 hour. Otherwise, you will not be able to understand. Listen. So what is this diagram? Let me explain this diagram to you people. Okay. So can you see this yellow color is the skin? This is the skin. Can you see this is skin? So just suppose this is the skin of my hand. This is the skin. Below skin, we have blood vessels everywhere. So this is a blood vessel you can see below skin. So this is a blood vessel you can see. This is the lining of the blood vessel by endothelial cells. So these cells are endothelial cells. Can you see? These cells are endothelial cells. The lining of the blood vessel cells are endothelial cells. It is a blood vessel. Inside blood vessel, we have RBC, WBC, platelet. Currently, I am concerned only with WBC. That's why I have drawn these green colored cells WBC. That is my army. So that is WBC. So WBC is present inside the blood vessel. Done. Done. Now, any microbe is entering inside my skin. The microbe can be bacteria, can be parasite, can be fungus, can be virus, anything it can be. So can you see this purple colored dot? It is a microbe. It is an injurious agent. It is the microbe. It is a terrorist. It has entered the wrong country, wrong territory. Done. So it is like a terrorist, and this is our army. Now I want both of them to fight, right? So that if the microbe will win, I will have infection. If the army will win, I will have inflammation. So let's see who is winning. But for them, for that, I have to make them fight. For fighting, they should meet each other. How they will meet each other? The problem is that microbe is extramuscular. It is present outside the blood vessel. And the army, that is WBC, is present intramuscular. It is present inside the blood vessel. So if you want to make both of them fight, you have two options. Either you take microbe inside, so they will fight. So it is a bad option. Because if you take bacteria inside the blood vessel, patient will have sepsis of all the organs. So it is a bad option. The other way around, you take WBC out. You take WBC out so that WBC can fight with the microbe and infection, inflammation can take place, can settle, can settle down. Have you got it? So yes, this is the correct answer. So all the 11 events I have told you, 5 vascular and 6 cellular, all these total 11 events are directed towards taking this WBC out. So finally, we will try to take this WBC out. So it is not directly WBC will go out. It will take 11 steps to take this WBC out so that it can fight with the microbe and do the phagocytosis. Give me a thumbs up. Give me a thumbs up fast. Give me a thumbs up. So, okay. So let me start with vascular events first. Have you got it? Everyone, I want those jitne listen kar rahe hain, utne thumbs up mujhe yahan chahiye. Everyone. Then only I will proceed. Otherwise, ask your doubt. I will come on the mediators later on, Krishna. Let me complete the steps first. I will come on the mediators also. Don't worry. I have covered it in this lecture only. Done? Okay. Done. Thank you. Thank you. Okay. So let me start with vascular events. As I have told you, there are 5 vascular events. I will start them one by one. Then I will come on 6 cellular events. So the first vascular event is transient vasoconstriction of the arteries. See, this is our master diagram. All the events, 11 events in this diagram only. Done. So can you see, as soon as microbe is entering, just suppose here, this is my hand. You can see the skin of my hand here. You can see this is the skin of my hand. Just below the skin, there is a microbe. You can see this is the microbe here. Just below the skin. It is extravascular. It is present outside the blood vessel. This is the blood vessel. It is outside the blood vessel. So as soon as this microbe is entering, the first thing body will do, the focal, this segment of the blood vessel undergo vasoconstriction. Only this segment, focal, not the complete blood vessel. So focally, this segment of the blood vessel will undergo vasoconstriction. Okay, I will try to become slow DNS, but you know, we have a lot of syllabus to get completed. I will try to do so. Okay, so that is known as vasoconstriction, but that is transient. That is only for few seconds, 3 to 5 seconds. So the first step is transient vasoconstriction. As soon as this microbe is coming, it comes in dar jayegi blood vessel. So there is focal vasoconstriction. That the first step is focal transient vasoconstriction. Everyone give me a thumbs up. So what will happen if you see from above here, I'm looking here, here is the microbe. If I'm looking here, so if you see from above here, so you will see, because there is focal vasoconstriction, there is less blood supply in this particular portion, in this portion. So the skin will look yellowish because of less blood loss. That is known as blanching. So this step leads to blanching, but that is transient. So that is transient vasoconstriction is the first step. Because of this, it will lead to blanching, that is yellowishness of the skin, whitish skin because of less blood supply. But it is transient, last only for 3 to 5 seconds. What is the second step then? Transient vasoconstriction is the first step. What is the second step? Persistent vasodilatation. Persistent vasodilatation. So this was the first step. As soon as this microbe is entering, the blood vessel is doing constriction, vasoconstriction, but it is transient. Transient. After that, there is vasodilatation. There is vasodilatation. This is vasodilatation and this is persistent. This is not transient. It will last for few hours. So that is persistent vasodilatation is the second step. As soon as this microbe is entering, the first step is vasoconstriction, which is transient. The second step is vasodilatation, which is persistent. Now if you look from above, how it will look? If you look here from above, you will look, this portion of the skin is looking more red. So that is rubor. Out of the 5 Celsius signs, cardinal signs, rubor is explained. Why rubor is occurring? Have you got it? Because of this vasodilatation, there is rubor. If there is more blood, there is more heat. So if you touch this portion, it will be warmer as compared to this and this portion. So this portion will be warmer as compared to this portion of the skin will be warmer as compared to this and this portion. So that is known as calor. Calor is also explained, heat. So rubor and calor is explained. Give me a thumbs up. Rubor and calor is explained. Give me a thumbs up. Have you got it? So that is the second step. So rhubarb and calor is explained based on this. So first step is transient vasoconstriction. Second step is persistent vasodilatation. Let me move on. The third step. The third step is increased hydrostatic pressure. Now, what do you mean by hydrostatic pressure? According to Starling's law, in any blood capillary, there are two type of pressure. The pressure due to water, it is outward pressure. Look at the arrows. It is outward pressure. It is known as hydrostatic pressure. And the pressure due to proteins, the protein present in the blood, albumin basically, it is an inward pressure. Inward, and it is known as oncotic pressure. So there are two types of pressure. One is outward, one is inward. The outward one is due to water. It is hydrostatic. The inward one is due to proteins. It is known as oncotic pressure. And normally they are balanced with each other. Now, as I am saying, this portion of the capillary is dilated. So there is more blood, so more water, so more hydrostatic pressure. Yes or no? So if any particular portion of the blood vessel is dilated, persistent vasodilatation is there. So there is more blood in this portion. More blood means more water. More water means more hydrostatic pressure. More hydrostatic pressure, so fluid will come out. The fluid from the blood will come out and it will accumulate outside. That will lead to edema. Edema. Now at your level, at your MBBS level, saying only edema is not sufficient. Whether the edema is transudate or exudate, you have to tell. There are two types of edema, transudate and exudate. So sirf edema nahi bolna hai. So what is the difference between the two types of edema? What is the difference? Here only fluid is coming out. Here only fluid is coming out. Now it is transudate. Transudate edema is only fluid. Then listen, I will come on exudate also. So here is the diagram from Robbins in front of you. You can see this is a blood vessel. This is a blood vessel. See here. See, appreciate the endothelial lining of the blood vessel. Endothelial lining. Please see, I'm marking it. Endothelial lining. And yes, see, you can see the proteins inside. These are dot, dot, dot are proteins, plasma proteins. So hydrostatic pressure is outward pressure. Oncotic pressure is inward pressure. Normally both are equal and opposite. Equal and opposite. Look at the arrow. Now look here. What has happened? There is this pressure is increased because of vasodilatation. Hydrostatic pressure is more and oncotic pressure is less. So try to see the background blue color here. So fluid is coming out. So that fluid is leading to transudate type of edema. Give me a thumbs up if you got it. So this edema is transudate. That is leading to tumor. That is leading to tumor. Done. So that is the third step. So vasoconstriction is there. Just a second. Give me a second. So vasoconstriction, which is transient. Vasodilatation, which is persistent. Increased hydrostatic pressure. Vasoconstriction leading to blanching. Vasodilatation leading to redness. That is rheumor. And heat, that is calor. Increased hydrostatic pressure leading to edema, which is tumor. So third cardinal sign is also explained. Coming on the fourth thing. The fourth thing is increased vascular permeability. Fourth step is increased vascular permeability. Ultimately, why we are doing also to take WBC out so that it can fight with the terrorist. How it will happen? Step by step, I will tell you. The fourth step is increased vascular permeability. Now listen, this step is the hallmark. From all 11 steps, not only these five and those six, total 11 steps means what is the hallmark step? Total 11 steps means the hallmark step is this one. Increase vascular permeability. What do you mean by that? Now listen, I'm telling you, I have to take this WBC out so that it can fight with this microbe. It can do the fight with this microbe, with this terrorist. How you will take this WBC out? There should be some hole now. There should be some hole from which you will take it out. Now you can see here the endothelial cells are continuous with each other. There is no gap. There is no gap in between. So how this WBC will come out if there is no gap? So we will create gaps from which later on this WBC will come out. So creating gaps in the lining of the blood vessel wall is known as vascular permeability. Increasing vascular permeability. So that is the most important step. Everyone give me a thumbs up. Everyone give me a thumbs up. Now I will tell you how we will do it. We will do it. See, I will tell you how we will do it. The gaps are created. Can you see the endothelial cell? This is one endothelial cell. This is another. This is another. Please appreciate the gaps between the two cells. Gaps. From those gaps, this WBC will come out later on in cellular state. Steps. Pehle gaps create to karo. Baad mein leke aayenge WBC ko bahar. First you create the gaps. We will take WBC out later on in cellular steps. In those six steps. Later on. First you create the gaps. So gaps are created, okay. But the gaps are created initially there were no gaps, so only fluid was coming out because of increased hydrostatic pressure. But now because there are gaps, along with fluid, protein is also coming out. So along with fluid, protein is also coming out because gap is there now. So again, edema will increase. disease, but this type of edema is known as exudate because it is protein rich edema. Along with fluid, there is protein also. In transudate, only fluid is there. In exudate, along with fluid, protein is also there. Have you got it? So see this diagram. No, rather see this diagram. See, this is a diagram from Robbins. You can see the first diagram is normal. First diagram is normal. Please see, this is a lining of the blood vessel. Appreciate the endothelial lining. Appreciate the endothelial lining. See the second diagram. In the second diagram also, the endothelial lining is same. There are no gaps. No gaps, only hydrostatic pressure is increased. So only fluid is coming out. Only fluid is coming out. Protein is not coming out. See, the background is blue. Done. See the third diagram. Third diagram. This is one endothelial cell. This is another. This is another. Please try to appreciate the gap between two consecutive endothelial cells. So gaps are there. From those gaps, protein is also coming out. So can you see? Protein is also the dot, 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 yellow color dots. Protein is also coming out. Should I zoom out? So should I zoom it out? Can you see here? The protein is also coming out. So this type of edema, this type of edema is known as exudate. So initially transudate is there and now exudate is there. Give me a thumbs up. Have you got it? Yes or no? Say yes or no. So that is the thing. So the four, the first step was, what are the four steps now? Just revise the four steps. What are the four vascular steps? Total five are there. Till now I have taught you four. What are the four vascular steps? What is the first one? It is vasoconstriction, which is transient. What is the second one? It is vasodilatation, which is persistent. What is the third one? It is increased hydrostatic pressure. What is the fourth one? It is increased vascular permeability. And last one is stasis. I will teach you that also. Stasis. Before that, you tell me what vasoconstriction leads to? It leads to blanching. What vasodilatation leads to? Vasodilatation leads to two things, rubor and calor. That is redness and bump. What increased hydrostatic pressure leads to? Edema. What increased vascular permeability leads to? Again, edema. But the two types of edema are different. Increased hydrostatic pressure leads to transudate type of edema. And increased vascular permeability will create holes, will create gaps. From that gap, proteins will come out. Proteins will also come out. So this type of edema is known as exudate type of edema. Give me a thumbs up. I tried really hard to explain you. I really tried. So edema is of two types. Transudate type of edema is due to increased hydrostatic pressure. And exudate type of edema is due to increased vascular permeability. Easy. Choti choti barikyon pe hi MCQs aayenge. So you have to pick all these things, the specifications. Give me a thumbs up, everyone. So now you should ask, ma'am, what is the mechanism of this increased vascular permeability? How the gaps are created? There are five mechanisms. These are the five mechanisms in front of you. How gaps are created? I will tell you all five. Don't worry. So the first most common mechanism is formation of endothelial gaps, endothelial cell contracts. This is diagram for five types, mechanisms for this increased vascular permeability. The diagram, all five diagrams are from Robbins only. Done. So the first mechanism is endothelial cell contraction. Listen. See, this is my master diagram. So can you see, this is one endothelial cell. This is another. There is no gap in them. So imagine a situation when the first cell is contracting, second is also contracting, third is also contracting. All the cells are contracting. So when they will contract, gaps will be automatically created between them. See, so this cell has contracted. This is also contracted. So when endothelial cells are contracting, gaps are created at junction. Give me a thumbs up. So this is the first mechanism by which we can create gaps in the wall of the blood vessels. So this mechanism is known as endothelial cell contraction. Give me a thumbs up. That is the most common among the five. That is the most common mechanism. The same diagram from Robbins. You can see this is one cell. This is another cell. This is third cell. There is no gap in between them. See the second diagram. This is first endothelial cell. This is second one. This is third one. Appreciate gaps between them. Can you appreciate this gap between the two consecutive, endothelial cells? Say yes or no. So this is a longitudinal diagram. If I cut it from here, imagine if I'm cutting it from here and looking at transversely. So how it will look like? So it will look like this. So what it is, this is one endothelial cell. This is one endothelial cell here. This is another endothelial cell here. This is the nucleus of each cell. The blue color is the nucleus. Yellow color is the cell. So two endothelial cells are covering the lining. And at the junction here, and here I can see the gap because both of them are contracted. Give me a thumbs up. Now the question arises, ma'am, why contraction is occurring? What chemical is causing this contraction? So the name of the chemical is histamine. Histamine is causing this contraction, and basically it is occurring in venules. Out of arteries, veins and capillaries, it is occurring in venules. And it is fast, onset is fast and duration is short. That is, you can say, how I explain you, it is immediate transient. What do you mean by immediate transient? So as soon as this microbe is coming, the endothelial cells are immediately contracting. So onset, as soon as after arrival, it is immediately contracting. So it is known as immediate, and it lasts for short duration. After contracting, they relax again. So that is, duration is also short. Onset is fast and duration is short. So immediate is indicating the onset and transient is indicating the duration. So immediate transient. Give me a thumbs up. So immediate type, transient type of reaction is this. This is the first one. Coming on the second mechanism, there are five mechanisms. Coming on the second, we have to create the gas to take WBCs out. We want the to create the tunnels from which we will take the army out so that it will fight with the terrorist. Like this. You can learn like this. Done. So that second mechanism, direct endothelial injury. Direct injury. What do you mean by that? Here, endothelial cells are not contracting. This cell, they are not contracting. So how you will create the gap? You have to take this WBC out anyway. So how you will create the gap? Here the gap will be created by the terrorist itself. The terrorist will come and it will cause the necrosis of the endothelial cells. It will cause the necrosis of the endothelial cells so that gaps will be created and it will challenge the army, come fight with me. So it is known as direct mechanism. By direct mechanism, the gap is created by the terrorist itself, that is microbe itself. Now it is not necessary the necrosis will be at the junction only. It can create at between the cell also, at the junction also, non-junction also, junction also. Give me a thumbs up. Again, if I cut here and see from the side, this will be the scenario. It can be at the junction, it can be at non-junction. It can be at junction, it can be at non-junction. Give me a thumbs up. It occurs in all three, arteries, veins and capillaries, not only in venules like the previous one. Done. And it is fast. It is also immediate, but it is not transient. It is delayed. That is, onset is fast, but duration is always. Once the necrosis is done, it is for always. No? So as soon as microbe is coming, it is immediately doing the necrosis. So onset is fast, immediate. But once necrosis is done, the gap is permanent. So that is, duration is delayed. So the first one was immediate transient. The second is immediate delay. Means onset in both of them, the first and the second, is immediate, but duration is different. The first one was transient, the second is delayed. Give me a thumbs up. I tried my best. Give me a thumbs up. The topic is difficult. Yeah. The third mechanism is leukocyte mediated injury. What do you mean by leukocyte? Leukocyte means WBC. So now that this is a microbe, it is coming here. We want to create the gap so that we can take WBC out. Here, endothelial cells are not contracting. The first mechanism failed. This microbe is not causing the injury. The second mechanism failed. How we will create gaps? We want to take WBC out anyhow. How we will create gap now? This army will create the gap. That is, WBC will go. They will cause holes and they will get out of it and challenge the terrorists that come fight with me. I'm out now. I have created the gaps for myself. Done. Have you got it? That is leukocyte mediated gaps. Done. Give me a thumbs up. So can you see these leukocytes are doing the gaps here? Again, it can be at the junction, it can be at non-junction. You can see this is a neutrophil. Neutrophil is causing the gaps. Done. Again, it is at venules. And it is, the first two were immediate. Immediate transient. The second was immediate prolonged. The third is delayed prolonged. So onset is also delayed and duration is also prolonged. So both the things are there. So let me summarize the first three if you have any confusion. So first one is formation of endothelial gas by contraction. The second is direct by terrorist. And the third one is by mediated by WBC, leukocyte mediated. Let me summarize the three. Let me, the first one is due to endothelial cell contraction. The second is direct. Direct is by injurious agent direct. And the third one is leukocyte mediated. Say yes or no. Have you got it? So what about the onset? And what about the duration of each of them? Onset and duration. Here onset is less, duration is also less. That's why known as immediate transient. Onset is immediate and duration is transient. The second one, onset is less, but duration is more. That's why known as immediate prolonged. So onset is immediate, but duration is prolonged. The third one, onset and duration both are high, both are too much. So that's why known as delayed prolonged. So you can learn, you can learn about I like this IT, IP, DP if you wish the mnemonic. I will come on stasis later on, Rahul. Let me finish the fourth step first now. The mechanisms of the fourth step, then I will come on the fifth step. So the fourth mechanism, these are the first three mechanisms. The fourth mechanism is increased transcytosis. Increased transcytosis. What do you mean by transcytosis? Trans means cell inside cell. Cytosis. Here no gaps are created. Still WBC will come out. You will say, ma'am, how WBC will come out without any gap? There should be some gap now here from which WBC will come out. No, WBC will enter inside this cell, endothelial cell, and come on that side. So how it will come? It is in the form of vacuoles. So some vacuoles are created. The WBC will enter inside this vacuole, and vacuole will take the WBC from this side and leave it from that side. Cell inside cell. Done. Have you seen? Can you see here? So this is known as transcytosis. Give me a thumbs up. So can you see here? Can you see the vacuoles here? Please appreciate the vacuoles. So that is transcytosis. Again, it occurs in vacuoles, and it is due to VEGF. Again, it occurs in vacuoles. And the last mechanism is leakage from new blood vessels. Wherever inflammation takes place, now new blood vessels are formed. This is known as angiogenesis. And new blood vessels are already leaky. They already have gaps because they are new. They have gaps in them. There is no need to create gaps in them. See, this is a new blood vessel. How you can identify it is a new blood vessel, it is not the old one. It is given. The diagram is self-depictive. Robbins is such a nice book now. You know, the diagrams of Robbins are like anything. So you can see it is a new blood vessel. How you have identified it is a new blood vessel, not the old one? See, there is a hint given in the question. See the nucleus. The nucleus is showing mitosis here. See the nucleus. The spindles in the nucleus. See the spindles in the nucleus. So the nucleus is showing the mitosis. It is showing it is a new blood vessel. So gaps are already there. There is no need to create the gaps. Done. Give me a thumbs up. So there are five mechanisms, the five diagrams. Who will help me in revising? Who among you will help me in revising? The first mechanism is endothelial cell contraction, the most common mechanism. The second mechanism is direct injury by the terrorist. The third is leukocyte-mediated injury by the WBC. The fourth one is vacuoles ke through, that is transcytosis. The fifth one is angiogenesis, formation of new blood vessels. Give me a thumbs up. The first three are important. The first three is immediate transient, immediate prolong, delayed prolong. Give me a thumbs up, everyone. I tried my best. I really tried my best. Here the culprit, let me tell you the culprit in each of them. The culprit is histamine. In the first scenario, the culprit is histamine, which is causing the contraction. In the second scenario, the culprit is microbe itself, which is causing necrosis of the wall. In the third scenario, the culprit is WBC, which is causing the hole. Then the fourth scenario, it is the vacuoles. Vacuoles inside vacuoles. In the fifth scenario, VEGF, vascular endothelial growth factor. Give me a thumbs up. Make a table of it. Make a table. All diagrams are from Robbins. Any diagram can come in your image-based question. IBQs are very common in FMG. No? You know last year how many IBQs are asked. So almost your 30 to 35% paper will going to be IBQ. Out of 300 questions, 30 to 35%, not questions, will be IBQs. Done. So more than among 90 to 100 questions you may expect, or more than that, it will be IBQs. So all the IBQs are really important for you. So IBQs learn nahi karne hai. You have to see all the images in the standard textbook. IBQ can be created from any of them. Now I can create more than 20 questions on these five images. I can create now only. I don't have time. Otherwise I can create and show you how IBQs are created. So I can take any image and create an MCQ on it. But you know everything about it, then you can answer it. Give me a thumbs up. Done. So should I proceed? Ultimately, because of one of these five mechanisms, the gaps are created. Now, when microbe is coming, the gaps are created. Now, these gaps are created either due to endothelial cell contraction or by the microbe itself or by WBC or by transcytosis or by angiogenesis, whatever mechanism, gaps are created. Now, the next step, we have to take WBC out of that gap. Have you got it? So we are done with the fourth step, increased permeability. There are five mechanisms of permeability. I have already enumerated them. And last step is stasis. Rahul, I am there on the stasis. Last step is stasis. Nothing to explain in this. Now, stasis will increase the viscosity. You know, this is the scenario till now. Till now, what has happened? The first step was transient vasoconstriction. The second step was persistent vasodilatation. You can see it is vasodilatation here. It is persistent vasodilatation. The third step is increased hydrostatic pressure, because of which fluid will move out. It will lead to transudate type of edema. The fourth step is increased vascular permeability, because of which protein will also move out and it will lead to exudate type of edema. And there are five mechanisms for this increased permeability. And ultimately, there is stasis. All the fluid is moving out, only cells are remaining. Imagine a situation of all the fluid. Now, blood have two things, cells and fluid. Fluid is plasma. So all the plasma is already moved out. All the protein is already moved out. What is left? Only cells are left, RBC, WBC, platelet. So they will show the stasis there. That is increased blood viscosity. Give me a thumbs up. So the five steps are over. The five vascular events are over. I have to come on six cellular events very fast. Are you people there? Should I continue? Say yes, fast. So first, help me in revising the five vascular events. What is the first vascular event? Write in the chat box. First vascular event. What is the first vascular event? This is Norman master diagram. I will show you all events here only. Yes. Yes, Catherine. Yes, you all are right. Virendra, Dr. K, everyone is right. So the first event is vasoconstriction, but stay transient. Yes, Ajay, it is transient. Good, it is transient. What is the second step? Yes, vasodilatation, but say it is persistent. It is persistent. Vasodilatation is persistent. It is the second step. What is the third step? Increased hydrostatic pressure, which will lead to edema. You can see here, edema. What is the fourth step? Increased vascular permeability, which will create holes. There are five mechanisms of increased vascular permeability. Here are the five mechanisms. I'm not revising again. Done. And this is the last fifth step, that is blood stasis. So these are the five steps. Now, who will prove these five steps? There is some mechanism, there is some experiment. Who can prove these five steps? I'm saying there are five steps and you just believe it. It is not the thing. No, you should prove it. So there is an experiment known as triple response experiment. This experiment is done by Lewis. This experiment is done by Lewis. That's why also known as Lewis experiment. So what this Lewis has done, he has taken a pen or a pencil or any object with a blunt end. So he has taken a forearm. On the forearm, he has given a stroke. A big stroke. I can't give it to myself. It will hurt. So stroke to himself or herself, whatever. Then so Lewis has given a stroke on the forearm by a blunt point object. So injury is there. So injurious agent is there. So injurious agent is the physical injury here. Done. So the all the events should take place one by one. So after that, he has noticed three things. What three things? Let me see. Where is my pen? I will show you. Okay. What three things he has noticed? So just suppose here is the stroke. Can you see this line? Here is the stroke. So immediately after giving the stroke, the line becomes red. That line, the stroke line becomes red in color. So the first thing he has noticed is red line. This is known as red line. Can you see a red line? After that, the area around the stroke becomes red. The area also becomes red around the stroke. The second thing, it is known as flare. See here, it is known as flare. And the third thing, the whole area swell up. The whole of this area swell up. So this third thing is known as bleed. So this is known as triple response. Now from your five vascular events, you will tell me why there is red line, why there is flare, and why there is bleed. You have to tell me. So the five events will be proven. Yes or no? So you have to. So red line, flare, and bleed. Why there is red line? So immediately after giving the stroke, there is vasoconstriction, which is not visible here. But there is vasodilatation. So first, there is vasodilatation of capillaries, which is leading to this red line. So immediately, the capillary beneath it will be dilated. Persistent vasodilatation, which is giving red line appearance here. After that, the adjacent arterioles will also get dilated. Aspaske arterioles will also get dilated, which is giving this flare. So this is due to vasodilatation. This is also due to vasodilatation. And then the whole area swells up. Swells up means edema. Edema is due to two reasons. Number one, increased hydrostatic pressure. That is transudate type of edema. And then increased vascular permeability leads to exudate type of edema. Both these edema are leading to bleed. So that's how we can prove this. And there is no experiment to prove the stasis. So that's how these steps are proved. Give me a thumbs up. So what is triple experiment? Triple response experiment. Have you got it? Should I launch the post based on this? Vascular events are over. After that, there are cellular events. Do you want me to put the post from the past year questions here based on this topic? Say yes or no in the chat box. If you say yes, you have to give me 1 minute. Not 1 minute exactly, few seconds. Okay, done. So this is the first question in front of you. You have only 15 seconds to answer it. Be fast and be accurate also. Be fast and accurate. Yes. What is the answer? What is the answer? What I have asked in the question? In the question, I have asked what is the sequence of events in acute inflammation, in vascular events. I have taught you only vascular events, not the cellular events. Be fast. Yes. So Anand, Haritha and Hema are first to answer it correctly. The correct answer here is D. So the first is transient vasoconstriction followed by persistent vasodilatation. Then increased hydrostatic pressure is not given here. The third step missing. Then fourth one is increased vascular permeability. Last step is stasis. So this is the correct sequence and rest of them are kuch na haphazard hai. So it is not correct. So correct answer here is D and most of you are right. I'm happy about it. I'm happy. So correct answer here is D. This is the next question in front of you. Fast. Be fast. This is a difficult one, I guess. Have I marked it correctly? In acute inflammation due to contraction of endothelial cells, which of the following will result? Which of the following? Now, the first mechanism we are talking about, that is increased vascular permeability. Sorry, by mistake, I have marked the incorrect answer. I have marked A as correct answer. A is not the correct answer. Correct answer here is B. Correct answer here is B. So most of you are right. Those who have marked B are right. Those who have marked A are not right. So correct answer here is B. I have told you now it is the immediate transient type of response. The first one. The second one is immediate prolonged. And the third one is delayed prolonged. So 1, 2, 3, you have to learn it in that sequence only. So correct answer here is that. Let me come to the next question. Yes, this one. Increased permeability in acute inflammation is due to which mediator? Is it due to histamine, IL-2, TGF-beta? It is beta and FGF. What about it? Increased permeability. There are 5 mechanisms of permeability. So the first one is endothelial cell contraction. It is due to histamine. That's why histamine is the correct answer here. It is not mentioned which mechanism they are asking. They are asking about overall all 5 mechanisms. The second direct one is due to the microbe itself. The third one, leukocyte mediated, is due to WBC. The fourth one, transcytosis, is due to vacuoles. And the last one, angiogenesis, is due to VEGF. If the option contains VEGF also, it is also correct. But here only histamine is there among the options. That's why my correct answer here is A. A is the correct answer. Shriyansh, Richard and RN are first to answer it correctly. Okay. Okay. What is the most characteristic feature of acute inflammation? That is hallmark. Hallmark from the 5 steps or hallmark from all 11 steps. I have told you the specific step. There are 11 steps. Now, from all 11 steps, what is the hallmark step? Yes. Most of you are right. It is increased vascular permeability. Creating gaps is the most crucial step. If there will be no gaps, how WBC will come out? WBC will only come out if there will be gaps. So correct answer here is C. Correct answer here is C. Virendra, Sindhu and Hema are first to answer it correctly. Correct answer here is C. This is the next question in front of you. What is the first step which occur in acute inflammation? The first step. What is the first step? Most of you are correct. The correct answer here is vasoconstriction. Many students mark it as vasodilatation because vasoconstriction is transient, but it is there. Don't neglect it. Although it is transient, but it is present. So it is for few seconds only, but it is the first step. So the first step is vasoconstriction. If it was not there in the option, then I will go with vasodilatation. But if it is present in the option, go with vasoconstriction. Correct answer here is B. So Virendra, Richard and Shriyansh again first to answer. Very good. Very good. So that is the thing. Correct answer here is B. This is the next question in front of you. Rubor is due to. Rubor. Rubor means, Latin mein rubor means redness. Redness is due to which of the following step? Is it due to dilatation, vasodilatation of the arterioles, increased vascular permeability, increased viscosity, or is it due to edema? So most of you are right. The correct answer here is A. It is due to vasodilatation. So Catherwell, Yash and Jyoti are first to answer it correctly. Increased vascular permeability will lead to exudate type of edema, not to rubor. Those were marked B. Give me a thumbs up if you got it. Give me a thumbs up if you have any doubt. If you have any doubt, please write in the check box. Done. Should I proceed? Those who are wrong, do you have any argument or doubt? Should I proceed ahead? This is the next question in front of you. Please read the question correctly. Except is asked on the question. all of the following vascular changes are observed in acute inflammation, except which of the following is not a vascular event? Is not a vascular event. So vasodilatation, yes, it is the second number step. Stasis, it is the fifth number step. Increase vascular permeability, it is the fourth number step. But decrease hydrostatic pressure, no, it is increased hydrostatic pressure, which is the third number step. So incorrect among them is D. Because decreased is given. Decrease is not there, it is increased. So incorrect among them is D. That's why D is our answer. So Haritha, Saurabh, and Harshita are first to answer it correctly. Very good, guys. Very good. So correct answer here is D. Should I proceed ahead? Should I proceed ahead? Okay, let me proceed ahead. The following host tissue response can be seen in acute inflammation except. The question contains except. Okay, let me mark the answer first. Okay, this is the poll in front of you. In acute inflammation, what is not seen? What is the exception in acute inflammation? The following host tissue response can be seen in acute inflammation except. I'm asking the exception. Most of you are right. Exudation is seen. Exudation means exudate type of edema. It is seen. Vasodilatation is seen. Okay, margination. Many of you have marked as margination. Margination is one of the cellular events. I'm going to tell you the six cellular events also. So it is also seen in acute inflammation. But granuloma is seen in chronic inflammation, not in acute inflammation. So incorrect among them is D, not C. So D is the correct answer. Hardi, Anand, and Jyoti are first to answer it correctly. So the correct answer here is D. Should I proceed ahead? Should I proceed ahead? Done. Should I proceed ahead? Lewis experiment, Imran, I have already explained. Now, triple response experiment is the Lewis experiment. Just let me see. Okay. What confusion do you have in Lewis experiment? Do you have any confusion? This is the Lewis triple response experiment. Imran and Kenny are saying to explain it again. So as soon as I give a stroke on with a blunt object on any body organ, just on forearm, so three things will happen. Initially, the line will become red. That is due to vasodilatation of the capillary. Then the area around it will also become red. That is known as flare, the second response. It is due to vasodilatation of the adjacent arterioles. Then due to edema, due to exudate as well as transudate type of edema, that is increased hydrostatic pressure and increased vascular permeability, the whole area will swell up. So swelling is known as V. So this is a triple response. That is red line, flare, and V. Imran, can you give me a thumbs up if you got it? Give me a thumbs up if you got it. Should I proceed? Should I proceed now? That was your doubt. Okay, so let me proceed ahead now. Let me proceed ahead. So let me come on the cellular events now. Cellular events now. Vascular five events are over. Let me come on the cellular six events. I have to complete six more events now. Cellular events now. Listen, till now what has happened? Till now this has happened. In the five vascular events, this is the story of movie till now. This is intermission. After intermission, there is a twist on the story. Listen now, listen the story. So this is a blood vessel you can see. There is a microbe who has entered inside my just below the skin. The microbe is present. Let me draw the skin. I forgot to draw. So this is the skin. Just below the skin, microbe is present. Microbe is extravascular. And this is a blood vessel you can see here. Inside the blood vessel, WBCs are present. These are the WBCs. These are present inside the blood vessel. And we have already created the gaps by one of the five mechanisms. We know there are five mechanisms. By one of the five mechanisms, we have already created the gaps. Now, what is the problem? You will say, ma'am, what is the problem now? Just take this WBC out and make a fight. So, maza waza hai kuch movie mein. Yes or no? So, it is not that way simple. Now, what is the problem here? Listen, have you heard Bernoulli's theorem in physics in your childhood? Yes, you have heard. So, Bernoulli's theorem states that in a pipe, in a hollow pipe, whenever any fluid is traveling in a hollow pipe, the heaviest portion of the fluid will travel at the center and the light portion of the fluid will travel at the periphery. That is Bernoulli's theorem, we already know. So in our blood, there are three types of cells, RBC, WBC, platelet, and plasma. Plasma is the liquid. So total four things are there in the blood. Heaviest among them is WBC. So WBC travels at the center. This is the thing. So WBC travels at the center. Around WBC, there is a layer of RBC. Around that, there is a layer of platelet. And most outermost is the plasma, which is the lightest. Give me a thumbs up. This is known as axial blood flow. This is known as axial pattern of blood flow. This is normal inside me, inside you, inside every human being. It is like this only. This is the thing. Now, the holes, the gaps are present at the periphery. The thing which has to come out of this gap is present at the center. So how it can directly come out of the gap? WBC is present at the center. It is the heaviest. it is present at the center. Agar ye periphery pe hota, if the WBC is at the periphery, it can easily come out. But now it is difficult for WBC to come out because it is surrounded itself by the RBCs, platelets, and plasma. It has to cross everything first before coming out of the gap. Have you got it? Give me a thumbs up. Give me a thumbs up. So first step, what I have to do first, see here, everyone see here. I'm marking here the first cell. This is the WBC. See here. So the first thing, WBC have to come at the margin. This is known as margination. The first step is margination. I will tell you six steps. The first step is margination. So WBC is leaving the center and coming at the margin. So all WBCs leave the center and come at the margin. This is known as margination. The first step, margination. This is known as reverse axial blood flow. So temporarily, blood flow is reverse axial. That is, heavy thing is traveling at the periphery due to acute inflammation. Give me a thumbs up. So after that, now it is not that the thing. Now the WBC just come at the periphery and hole is present there only. Hole yahan pe present hai. Hole is present here. So WBC has to travel a certain distance before approaching the hole. So for traveling that distance, the WBC roll. WBC do the rolling like a tire on a road. This is a road and this is a tire. Like a tire on the road, WBC will travel on the endothelial lining. Done. So this is, yes, rock and roll, can you? So it is doing rolling. So when I will tell you the mechanism of this rolling now, then actually it will be rock and roll. Your mind will also rock and roll. So it is difficult how rolling is done. How WBC don't have eyes. It is not that it is rolling. How it is done? It is in the form of receptors between the two cells. So can you see the first cell? The cell here is endothelial cell here. And the second cell here is WBC, this WBC. So temporary bonds are formed between the two. You can see bonds are formed between the two, and bonds are forming, breaking. So initially bond is formed, it is transient bond. Again, it will break, WBC will move ahead. Then bond is formed, then move ahead, then bond. So that is how rolling takes place. So rolling is the second step. So first step is margination. Second is rolling. After that, the gap is there. The rolling. WBC approaches the gap. Just before the gap, it has to stop now. It does not have to roll now. It has to stop. This is known as adhesion. So the third step is adhesion. Third step is adhesion. Done. That is adhesion. After adhesion, WBC will come out. WBC will come out of the blood vessel. Leave the intracellular space and come to the extravascular space. Done. That is the main thing. That is transmigration. Don't confuse it with margination. This is transmigration, the fourth step. After coming out, what it has to do? It has to fight with the microbe. Yes, it has to fight with the microbe. No, WBC don't have eyes that he will see here and there. Where is the microbe? Where is the microbe? I will move in that direction. When the WBC will come out, it is a three-dimensional space. Now, after that, where the WBC has to go? How WBC will come to know that microbe is this way and I have to go this way, not this way? So this microbe will secrete certain chemicals inside it, from it. Chemicals, and that chemicals will attract the WBC towards it. That is known as chemotaxis. That is movement towards chemical. So the fifth step is chemotaxis. And after reaching at the microbe, it will eat the microbe. That is phagocytosis, last step. So tell me the six steps. Tell me the six steps. What are the six steps? Who will tell me the six steps? These are the six steps shown here also, and these are the six steps in robins. You can see, I will mark it for you. This is the WBC. First, it is doing margination. It is coming on the margin. The first step is margination. After that, rolling. After that, adhesion. This is adhesion. This is rolling. This is margination, rolling, adhesion. After that, transmigration. It is coming out. See, it is coming out. After transmigration, it is going towards the chemical. This red dots are chemical. That is chemotaxis, towards chemical. After that, it is eating the microbe. The yellow color capsule is the microbe. That is phagocytosis. Now you tell me the six steps. You tell me what are the six steps. These are the six steps. Then I will tell you the detail of each of them. So margination, rolling, adhesion, transmigration, chemotaxis, and phagocytosis. Now, can you enumerate all 11 steps? The 5 from the vascular and 6 from cellular. Okay, you do it by yourself. I'm not asking you. So total 11 steps are there that I'm revising you. Done. Listen, the same six steps are shown here also. This is margination, rolling, adhesion, transmigration, chemotaxis, and phagocytosis. The six steps. Now, let me tell you, margination is very easy. In margination, there is reverse axial blood flow takes place. Reverse axial blood flow is taking place. So one by one, we will see margination is easy, nothing to tell in margination. Okay. Margination also known as paumentation. Paumentation is another name of margination, you can see. The second step is rolling, and third step is addition. These two are difficult. Most difficult to understand are these two steps, rolling and adhesion. How I will explain you these two steps, let me tell you. So rolling is due to transient bond formation between the two types of cells. What are the two types of cells? I have told you now, this is endothelial cell. See, this is endothelial cell. This is endothelial cell. The red one are the endothelial cell, and the green color are the WBC. This is WBC. This is WBC. So WBC is rolling over endothelial cell. So bonds are formed between the two. So corresponding molecules are present between the two, which form bonds with each other. So there are five pairs. There are five pairs. I will tell you the name of those five pairs. These are known as complementary adhesion molecules, CAM, complementary adhesion molecules, the five pairs. Listen, rolling, and after adhesion, the bonds are firmer. Same bonds are firmer. They will become more firmer. So what is the mechanism of rolling and adhesion? It is due to complementary adhesion molecules, CAM. These are the five pairs. Okay, I will draw it for you to simplify. Many MCQs are coming from this portion. Listen. So can you see this diagram? Can you see this diagram? I have simplified it for you. Okay, let me see. Okay. So can you see endothelium? This is endothelium. You can see the five pairs. The five pairs. In each pair, you have to tell me which molecule is present on endothelium and corresponding molecule on the WBC. Anything cannot form bond with anyone. So there are specific pairs. There are specific pairs like P-selectin and E-selectin is present on endothelium. I have drawn, this is P-selectin here and this is E-selectin here. They form bond with Siluyl-Lewis X. Both of them, they form bond with Siluyl-Lewis X on WBC. So the first and second pair is done. I will tell you five pairs. So the first pair is P-selectin on endothelium. It forms bonds with Siluyl-Lewis X on WBC. The second pair is E-selectin on endothelium. It will also form bond with Siluyl-Lewis X on WBC. Give me a thumbs up. The third pair, L-selectin. There are three selectins, P, E and L. L is for leukocyte. L-selectin is present on WBC, not on endothelium. P and E is present on endothelium. There are three selectins. The third selectin, L. L for leukocyte is present on WBC. So it is present on WBC and it will form bond with glycam. Glycam on endothelium. So what is the third pair? This is the third pair. Glycam on endothelium. It will form bond with L-selectin on the WBC. Give me a thumbs up. Now I will tell you fourth and fifth, last two pairs. Fourth and fifth. So the fourth and fifth pair on the integrins are there. ICAM and VCAM is present. Let me tell you. So this is ICAM and this is VCAM. Glycam ke baad ICAM and TCAM on the endothelium, and it will form bonds with the integrins. This is beta 2 integrin. This is beta 1 integrin. That is ICAM forming bond with beta 2 and VCAM forming bond with beta 1. I know it is bad, but you have to learn. So ICAM forming bond with beta 2 and VCAM forming bond with beta 1. Give me a thumbs up. Everyone give me a thumbs up. Everyone. Yes, can you? You have to remember all of these. I will show you MCQs from your past year exams only asked on this concept. This is a simplified way I have discovered to memorize you. No one will memorize you pair by pair like this drawing. It is given here, na? Robins. You can see here it is given in the Robins here in a bad way. It is everywhere. You can't understand it. Have you got it? So you just draw like this only. I have drawn. Have you got it? So these are the five pairs. Let me tell you the sixth pair also. Last pair. How transmigration takes place? Transmigration. That is how this WBC do not have eyes. No hole is coming. Oh, I have to jump into the hole. It is not that way. Again, it is in the form of receptors. So receptors are present on these endothelial cells also, and corresponding receptors are present on this WBC also, which pushes it downwards into the hole, into the gap. So what receptors are present? So the last pair here is PCAM. Here I have shown here also. Where is my diagram? Just let me see where is my diagram. This one. Can you see this WBC is coming out? So can you see this receptor? This one. And this corresponding receptor. So only one receptor which is common for both endothelial cells also, WBC cell also, is PCAM. PCAM is also known as CD31. Learn it. So the last pair is PCAM CD31 on both of them, which helps in transmigration. Listen, give me a thumbs up, everyone. Have you got it? One more important thing here. The first pair leads to rolling. The second pair leads to rolling plus adhesion both. The third pair again leads to rolling only. Fourth and fifth leads to addition. So rolling plus addition, rolling, addition. Last one is transmigration. You have to learn in sequence only. The six pairs, the corresponding pairs, which molecule on endothelium, which molecule on WBC, and which is leading to what? Rolling ke liye kaun si important hai, addition ke liye kaun si important hai, transmigration ke liye kaun si hai, dono ke liye kaun si hai. So how third one is for rolling? Rolling needs only transient bond formation and adhesion needs firmer bond formation. Rolling ke liye these pairs are forming, breaking. During adhesion, once they are formed, they are not breaking. That is the difference between them. So some pairs are transient, some are permanent. You have to learn which one is transient, which one is permanent. Give me a thumbs up, fast. So these are the pairs. My time is over. Okay. So these are the pairs. Done. So I'm done with this topic. So I'm done till here. Still transmigration, chemotaxis and phagocytosis is remaining from acute inflammation and complete chronic inflammation is also remaining. Questions are also remaining, but the link is expiring now. So how I can continue? My next link is waiting to get started. Done. So my next link after 5 minutes is there. So just give me one minute. So I'm ending this lecture just after 5 minutes. It is 4:10. Just after 5 minutes at 4:15 p.m. Join another link. Which link? IBQs. So daily we will discuss 10 IBQs from all multiple subjects. Today's subject is pathology. From pathology we will start. In pathology today, all images are from CVS and blood vessels. So CVS and blood vessels we will finish. We will do important 10 image-based questions on it or more than it if time allows. So in the next 1 hour, we are going to discuss it. Now, what about this? You have to tell me, do you want another lecture on it? So remaining portion of the cellular events, the remaining story and chronic inflammation. So it will take another 45 minutes, I guess. So we can do it tomorrow. Done. So tomorrow we can do it. So, okay. So don't go anywhere. Join me back after 5 minutes at 4:15 for IBQ session for FMGE. Please join me back. So I'm ending this lecture. Refresh yourself. Have a cup of tea. Have a cup of coffee. Come back in just 5 minutes. Okay. See you. Bye-bye. I'm ending it.